What every Adventist scientist should know about uranium lead dating. We're in the middle of a series on what every Adventist scientist should know, and in my opinion, in most cases, what every Christian scientist should know. We talked about the philosophy of science already. There's a whole section on Is There a God that we'll try to get lined up for you. Some of the topics involved are listed there. There is a section that we're going through right now on how old is life on Earth and was there a flood. And 2 weeks from now we'll be talking about widespread layers and correction rates of erosion. We've already talked about carbon-14 dating, and today we'll be talking about uranium-lead dating. We also are going to be talking about challenges to young life creationism. And finally, we'll be talking about some information in Ellen White's health messages, because they are, after all, science related. And they're certainly pertinent to Adventism. Uranium-thorium lead dating. The general method we're going to talk about first, then we're going to talk about Gentry's 1976 article in Science, and finally we're going to talk about helium diffusion versus uranium lead. The last two of those have as a major player an Adventist, and I think we should all know about it if we're going into the sciences. And then I'll give my own interim conclusion, and then you can make your comments. Uranium-thorium-lead dating starts out with three different isotopes of uranium and lead and thorium and their daughter elements. Uranium-238 decays through a series of steps, producing eight helium atoms on the way. The daughter, lead-206, and the half-life is measured in terms of 4 billion years. The isotope 235, which some of you may know is the one that's used in fissile material, atomic bombs, decays to lead-207, producing seven helium atoms along the way, and a number of electrons as well. And its half-life is somewhat shorter, 7/10 of a billion years. Thorium-232 decays to lead-208, producing six helium atoms along the way, again with a number of electrons. And that half-life is 14 billion years. And you don't have to know too much about exactly how that works, except that I will tell you that one of the products in each of those trains is actually a gas, which makes it interesting if you're going to try to assume that there can be no escape of daughter products. The assumptions that are necessary in order to make these a dating method, well, first of all, the easy way to do this is to start with a specimen with a parent isotope, say U-238, and no daughter isotopes, say no lead 206. And then all you have to do is figure out how much lead 206 you have, and how much uranium you have, project back how much uranium you had, and there's a mathematical formula that can give you the age. With very close approximation, the only fudge in the approximation is that all the intermediate products have to be accounted for as well. Unfortunately, It is very rare to have no daughter product originally. Usually there is some lead, which contains lead 208 as part of it. And so we kind of have to try another method. Perhaps there's a specimen with parent and some daughter initially, and then a specimen with daughter and no parent, and then you could figure out what the original isotope ratio was, and you could figure out how much extra lead-208 in this particular instance there is at the end, and find the original uranium concentration, and take the formula, turn the crank, and get your answer. But again, it is rare to have specimens with daughter and no parent, and so what is actually done is measuring specimens with varying amounts of parent and varying amounts of daughter, and hopefully not exactly all the same, so that you can get some with a lot of parent and very little daughter, and some with a lot of daughter and very little parent, and you can do some mathematical calculations as to how much you have left. And that's called isochron dating, because all of those are supposed to lie on a straight line. Now, I'm not going to go into the isochron dating in great detail right now. If you're interested, the book Scientific Theology, which is available on the internet for free, will go into isochron dating to a considerable degree. But the assumptions that are required for uranium, thorium, lead dating are: one, the radioactive decay constants have to have all been invariant. If they haven't, then if it decayed faster, then it has taken a shorter time. If it's decayed slower, it's taking a longer time. The lead isotopes were evenly distributed at the original time. If, for example, you had a lot of lead with a lead 208 to begin with, and lead with less 208 to begin with, then it's going to throw off your time as you assume that all of the lead isotopes were evenly distributed. Also, there can be no net uranium or thorium migration occurring since that time, because if thorium or uranium has been added to the specimen, then of course it looks younger than it is. If thorium has been, or uranium has been, leached out of the specimen, then it looks older than it is. No net migration of lead isotopes has occurred since that time. That is, you have to freeze those in place. No net migration of intermediate isotopes has occurred since the time, because we're dealing with isotopes that decay to other isotopes. For example, uranium-238 decays to thorium-234, then protactinium-234, then uranium-234, then thorium-230, then radium-226, then radon-222, and so forth. And the problem is, of course, that if the radium or the radon or the thorium has migrated anywhere, then it throws off the calculations. And finally, you have to assume that we can accurately measure the various isotope ratios in a given set of minerals, which is usually a pretty safe assumption. If those assumptions hold, there's a formula that can be derived, and I'm just going to put it up. And if you want to look at the entire formula in context, it's in the book Scientific Theology. And so when you get done, you have a slope to your isochron that has a factor of e to the kt minus 1. And since time is involved, you can reverse that, and you can get time equals the natural logarithm of the slope, that's just a fancy way of putting the slope, divided by k. Now, there are three different equations, one of them for uranium-238 and lead-204. One of them, uranium-238 and lead-206 measured against 204. One of them, uranium-235 and lead-207 against lead-204. And one of them, thorium-232 and lead-208 against lead-204. Now this is wonderful because, in theory, we should be able to get three different dates on any one of these crystals or any one of these samples, and they should all match. Now, that doesn't prove that the age is accurate because, in fact, all of those dates can be precisely duplicated by mixing lines. But probably more important, and this is from Guy and Schleicher absolute age determination, which is one of the more authoritative reviews, although it's probably from, it's 1993 by now. The ages obtained with the above equations are almost always discordant. That is to say, they don't give you the same age. Now, you may have heard that all radiometric dating gives you the same age. It sounds like two professionals in the field, at least in 1993, disagreed with that proposition. So what you do is you work with the Concordia method of uranium-lead dating. We've already noted that in this particular case, thorium dating is not considered valid. So what you do with the Concordia method is you assume that there has been change in the sample, but it happened at a particular time, and the uranium and the lead migrated together. And so the lead-208 divided by the uranium-238 is plotted against the lead-207 divided by the uranium-235. That should be 235, and that is my error. Where the ages match, where it would have been perfectly good, is called the Concordia line. Now, it's called a line, but it's not really a straight line. It might have been better to call it the Concordia curve, but that's what they call it. And this is a Concordia plot. This is a fairly standard plot. The curve moves outward in this way in a kind of quasi-exponential fashion. It's not exactly exponential, but it's pretty close. And this is lead-207 divided by uranium-235. This is lead-206 divided by uranium-238. And what you will typically get if you measure samples is a plot that looks something like this, with a point here, and a point here. Or perhaps four or five points, all on the same line. And that line is called a Discordia line. And what is supposed to have happened is this. About, in this particular case, 3 billion years ago, there was a sample that had a Concordia, a concord, if you like, of uranium-235 and uranium-238 dating. But it lost lead in an episodic process, and it lost varying amounts of lead, taking it down this straight line to the origin. If it lost all of its lead, then you would have a point at the origin, although usually that's not the case. Usually it will be just some of its lead that is lost. And one end points at 3 billion years, which was the original age, and one end points at zero. Now, you give this a half a billion years later, and now you have the intercept being 3.5 billion years, because half billion years has gone by, And that's the Upper Concordia Age. And so that was the original age of the material. And then the Lower Concordia Age is where the line intersects the Concordia line, which is now 500 million years. Now, that's kind of a long ways from our original simple way of doing things, but that's the way it goes. Now, the interesting point is that the upper age is usually up in, you know, way over 500 million years, a billion, 2 billion, 3 billion years, in which case it's well before most people would put the beginning of the flood, and so it doesn't really have much of an impact on a creation story. But the lower intercept is particularly interesting because it commonly does come at a point where we're dealing with flood deposits. And if we were constantly getting an accurate number, that would be somewhat disturbing from a short age perspective. But as Geyenschleicher put it, in many Archean areas, the lower intercept gives an age that cannot be assigned to any known geological event. This secondary value is then viewed as meaningless. So the dating method doesn't really work very well in that case. In fact, as they say a few pages later, a multi-stage history of detrital zircon or monazite can produce a pseudo-linear plot with intercepts between discrete metamorphic events, which are then without geologic meaning. Now, I'm a little confused about a pseudo-linear plot. It sounds kind of like a linear plot that we don't like. I mean, isn't it linear? It's just that it doesn't have the meaning that they want to make of it. So how do people who are using this for dating explain the Lower Concordia Age that doesn't have a real meaning? Well, there have been several different ways of doing of explaining it. And one of the proposed solutions is constant diffusion of lead from the zircon. Another one is radiation and damage induced diffusion of lead from the zircon. There are at least three other models out there. And then one model that says maybe it's just a mixing line. Now, the models themselves, interestingly enough, are not universally applied. That is to say, if you find a Lower Concordia Age you like, you keep it. If you find a Lower Concordia Age you don't like, you try to use one of these models to explain it away. That kind of looks to me like a little bit of cherry picking. And the models, once they're proposed, they should be universally used, or at least explain why they're not universally used because of some particular properties of that particular zircon. But regardless of what you do with those models, they still invalidate the Lower Concordia Age as representing real time. So even if all of those models are wrong, the Lower Concordia Age does not represent real time for a significant fraction of the dates that are done. Now, the Discordia line can be reproduced by a mixing line, and this is recognized in the literature. It can explain any straight Discordia line, which means that if it's generalized, then you don't have any particular basis for assuming that any of the Lower Concordia Ages are, in fact, real time. That means that the Discordia method is not self-checking. Unfortunately, Dalrymple in The Age of the Earth claimed that it was. I think he's wrong. I know he's an authority in the field, but if you have these kinds of problems and you start trying to explain around them, at that point I start saying you don't really have that hard data. But I would be in error if I didn't point out that there are even more problems with the conventional use of uranium lead dating. In an article in Science, which the full name of which is quite a mouthful, in 1976, Robert V. Gentry published an observation on radio halos in coalified wood. Now, radio halos are simply areas where a small amount of radioactive material is found at the center, and then alpha particles have gone out to a certain position and stopped. They do more damage near the end, and so even though in theory it should be kind of spreading around, in practice, so that these should be fading off because there's more concentrated alpha particle activity in the very center. The alpha particles at the beginning apparently don't tear off as many electrons as they go through, and they tend to do it more at the very end of their trail. By the way, that particular feature of charged heavy particles has been used in the proton beam down at the medical center, where the hydrogen atoms protons, are accelerated and then shot into human flesh. And as they go through, at first there's very little damage, and then as they near the end, they cause considerable damage by ionizing atoms that are in the body. And so you can use that kind of radiation more safely with less damage to the outside and more damage to the tissue that you actually want to radiate than if you use something like gamma rays from cobalt-60, for example, which is another way of ionizing, using ionized radiation. So it's a very practical thing. But the alpha particles come out to a defined range, and then when they get there, they cause a great deal of damage, so that you have these somewhat darkened rings. And in this particular one, you can see there are three rings. There's an outer ring, there's a middle ring, and there's an inner ring. This is a polonium halo. Started out with three isotopes of polonium throwing out alpha radiation. Now, there are also uranium halos, and they have usually these three plus another kind of indistinct halo that's the result of a lot of overlapping ones just inside the inside one that's drawn or that's photographed here. And Gentry studied polonium halos and uranium halos rather extensively and has done quite a bit of publishing in that area. And I'm not going to go into that area itself, although it's an interesting one. I suppose that every Adventist scientist should know that Robert Gentry is into polonium halos, but probably not to understand all of the nuts and bolts of it, because there are competing theories, and you rapidly get into mud if you try to understand exactly what's happening. But what I can tell you is that there are uranium halos, and the smallest one of these polonium halos was disputed for a long time, and so Robert Gentry was looking for some place where he could demonstrate that, yes, indeed, those polonium halos belonged there. Now, what he did was he found polonium halos in coal. And it's pretty well arguable that the polonium halos that are there are, elliptical, they're squashed, if you like, rather than being circular. And in fact, some of the places, I don't have your photo of this right now, it's one of the things I ran out of time doing, you can actually see the elliptical halo and then a circular one going up around like so. So it's not a matter of you couldn't make a circular halo, it's a matter of you made a circular halo and it got squashed. Now that implies that the polonium that turned into lead and made those halos did so before the wood was hard. And the fact that you have two different halos suggests that you had two different isotopes that had roughly the same, well, in fact, exactly the same, energy to their alpha particles, but they were going off at different times. And so you can even say that the wood was squashed somewhere between about 1 year and about 5 years. Those are not absolutely hard and fast, but they're pretty close, of when the wood got squashed. That means that you're talking about something that happened at coal formation. Presumably, that means that we're talking about something that happened about the time the coal was buried. That becomes important. Now, Dr. Gentry went on to note that uranium was found, uranium halos were found in the same vicinity, apparently being put there by the same event. And if you accept that, the uranium halos are very interesting in that they are what he called immature, that is to say the rings are not very well developed. That implies that there wasn't that much radiation from the uranium. And in fact, if you measure those uranium halos, you'll find there's very little lead in them. And you can read the article as to exactly how little lead. The uranium was deposited in Mesozoic coal. That was, the conventional age is about 100 million years old, okay? Presumably at the time of coal formation, which is probably, again, over 100 million years in the standard way of looking at things. It was done within 10 years of coalification as a kind of an outside figure. And they had these immature uranium halos, implying that they hadn't had that much time to produce alpha particle damage. And if you calculate from the uranium and the lead, I did this myself on his article, you come up with something like less than 300,000 years for those halos, which means coalification would have happened in less than 300,000 years if all of those assumptions are correct. Now, in one of his videos, Gentry actually says it's less than 100,000 years. I was counting the ones where he actually gave a ratio in the text, and he may be counting some of the ones where there was no detectable lead. And so he may be right. I can't say from the published material, but I can say that less than 300,000 years fits the model quite well. That's not something that you will hear most people talking about in Adventist education. And it's too bad. Because it's a piece of evidence that got into the peer-reviewed literature that kind of argues that coal isn't all that old, particularly Mesozoic coal. Now, I would not want to say that this proves that Mesozoic coal is that young, and it proves that there is a short age for life on Earth, but it's a piece of evidence that I think would be interesting and I think relevant to the discussion of how old life on Earth is. And the other one that I want to point out is also on uranium and lead, but this time involving how much helium has been put out. And that is was originally noted again by Robert Gentry and Associates, and this one made it into Geophysical Research Letters. This is 1982. It's in the published literature. It's not even like my stuff last year, where most of the information is not actually in the published literature. Certainly the experimental data in one particular case wasn't allowed into the published data. But Dr. Humphreys has worked on this in some detail, finding out how much helium diffusion has been there and turning Gentry's qualitative argument into a quantitative argument, which I think is quite impressive. And Humphreys' article is available on the internet. There was a well that was drilled in Fenton Hill, New Mexico. I think they were trying to get geothermal energy. And they did find warm to hot rock down below. The conventional age of the formation in which the well was drilled is 1.5 billion years. This was determined by uranium lead dating of zircons. Helium was retained in the crystals, which were, depending on where you were drilling, warm to hot, in some cases 200 degrees or above. Now, on a time scale that you would expect that helium should have all been gone, in fact, you're finding helium. And the question is, well, what kind of time scale would you have to retain that helium? So they measured the diffusion rates for these particular zircon crystals to see what we got. And the data is much more compatible with a young age than it is with an old age. In fact, here you can see the data that was obtained by the crystals. There were two waves of data, the one in 2002 and one in 2003, where they measured the temperature all the way down to close to room temperature. And you will notice that that if you assume that these things had all the helium that they would have gotten from decay, but it had only been about 6,000 years, more or less, since they were laid down, that you get a very nice fit with the experimental data. If you take a uniformitarian model, you're expecting much less helium. In particular, this is what, 10 to the 16th, more or less, and this is about 10 to the 22nd. So you're looking at six orders of magnitude change. That's huge. Now, again, I would not take that data and say this proves a young age. I don't think there is anything, a silver bullet that you can get that will just simply knock the long age timescale dead. The fact of the matter is, most of the time when these kinds of things happen, they're kind of brushed off as anomalies. And I would feel more comfortable if this were not the only borehole that had been tested. And I think that that's one of the things that creationists should do, is take their data out and test it some more. But it is an interesting piece of data. It does point toward short age, and it involves an Adventist scientist, and I think that every Adventist scientist should at least know about the data. And that means I think they should be taught the data, or at bare minimum, they should be given the website so they can look it up for themselves. Now, to summarize the uranium-lead stuff, I would say the conventional use of uranium-thorium-lead dating is like an onion, where one layer doesn't work, so you peel it away and you try another layer and you peel it away again. They're based on successively more complex and I think successively more unlikely assumptions, and it still does not consistently give the answers desired by long-age advocates. I think there are major theoretical and practical problems with this application. And finally, I think that there is good evidence that when it is properly applied, it may actually argue for a short age for life on Earth. But I want to point out one last thing. I am not arguing that all of uranium lead dating should be tossed out on its ear. I'm arguing instead that it should be carefully reevaluated. However, I am arguing that the contrary data should be presented to future Adventist scholars, future Adventist scientists. Now, there are some who would not like that to be done. They would argue that the contrary data might give the students false hope. Of course, that argument depends on knowing that the hope is in fact false. And it also assumes that students can't be trusted to decide for themselves by looking at the data. I think it should be seen as a power play. And I think that we should not be doing those kinds of things in Adventist education. We should be training people to think for themselves and not, as one author put it, to be mere reflectors of other men's thoughts. But that's my opinion. Now, it's your turn. Now we have a question way up in the back. And I think we have one there, and then one.
Well, I came in late, so I think maybe you've already addressed this. But right at the end, you said this data could be seen as an argument for recent life on Earth. Isn't this maybe the cold data, but the data involving rocks? Is that an argument for a recent Earth?
The argument, I think, has to do with something big happened at 6,000 years more or less. What that something big happened is not clear. Was that a creation event? Was that the flood? Was that, you know, some kind of accelerated decay in between or perhaps after? Was that when creation upset the zircons and drove all the helium out of them? And then new helium was added later on? Or perhaps was that an event that drove helium into the zircons at that point in direct proportion to how much uranium they had? The answer is any of those models will kind of fit. But what's hard to fit is a standard model that says things have been going on the same way they've been going on for 1.5 billion years. Something funny happened at best estimate 6,000 years ago. 6 ± 2, if you look at the data, there's some of them that will date to, say, 7,000, some of them that date to 2,500 or something like that. I'm not trying to give the, we could spend an entire session just going over that, and we could probably take an hour doing so. But I'm not trying to make a complete and exhaustive argument. But what I am trying to say is, here's interesting data. It's not being looked at as often as it ought to. I think an Adventist that gets out of an Adventist educational institution that doesn't know anything about this data that was started by an Adventist, I think is not getting an adequate education.
I have both a question and a comment. I'll make the comment first. Whether the age established by the techniques that you're employing would turn out to be 300,000, or whether it would turn out to be 4 or 5 billion or 13.7 billion, doesn't really matter. If the question is the Genesis account of creation to be taken literally or to be taken figuratively, either of those possibilities would mean that it's to be taken figuratively, and then you have to turn to evidence outside the Bible to determine the real age that's being referred to figuratively, it seems to me. Now, the question I wanted to ask is, when you move from geology to cosmology, and you consider Wilson and Pazias's dating using radioactive or radiation from the Big Bang and its decay or diminishing to establish an approximate age for the universe of around almost 14 billion years, how do the remarks that you've made about the unreliabilities and inconsistencies of this kind of dating apply to Wilson and Penzias's determination there?
The short answer is they don't. You have to keep in mind that there are three different questions, and they're often believed to be identical to each other, but they are not necessarily. The first question is, how old is the universe? And that's the data you were referring to. The second question is, how old is the Earth itself and perhaps the solar system? And that's an entirely different question. It would be tempting to say that if you believe in an old universe, you've got to believe in an old solar system. But it's not true. And the third one is how old life on Earth is. And again, it's tempting to tie it to the other two, but it's not necessary. That is to say, life on Earth could be young, while the Earth itself is old. 4.5 billion years, why not? And I think that when you really start getting into the meat of Genesis 1 from a straightforward reading is when you start saying that life was older. And that's why I didn't bother with the Upper Concordia age. Some of my colleagues who want a young Earth And a young universe will have to do something with the Upper Concordia age as well. I didn't particularly bother with it, because for me, if the Lower Concordia age is not reliable, then all of the fossiliferous material doesn't count. Now, I will make one other point regarding your comment, which is, I think, important. If you'll notice, there was a less than sign in front of the 300,000 years. How much less than? You can't say. It could be 50,000 years. It could be 20,000 years. It could be 5,000 years. It could be 4,300 years. It could be 2,000 years, except that I don't think too many people believe that coal was formed 2,000 years ago. But from that data, you can't say. All you can say, it was long enough for it to just start to make the halo. So it's not 0 years, and it's not, say, 100 years. I think you can safely say that. But anything in between, well, if you believe Gentry, 100,000 years, and 4,000 years would be acceptable.
The point I was making, of course, and I agree with what you said, was that if the account in Genesis is figurative, and it wasn't six literal days, let's say, then you have to turn the evidence outside the Bible to determine how many days, or how many years, or billions of years, or hundred thousands, or whatever it actually was. And the question then becomes, which of these various techniques that you've discussed comes closest to approaching some kind of answer? And that suggested one more question to me that I'm asking, simply because I'm not nearly as well informed as you are, obviously, in this area. Where does potassium-argon dating fit into the comments that you made?
We hopefully will deal briefly with potassium-argon dating when we discuss problems, radiometric dating in general, and that will come under problems for a short age.
Do the weaknesses and inconsistencies that you pointed out have any application to potassium-argon dating?
They kind of do. Potassium-argon dating is a different method, but it does have some weaknesses of its own. And part of what the game is becomes evident when you look at a fossiliferous deposit in Argentina, or more precisely, a footprint full deposit. In that particular case, the deposit was dated by index fossils and by potassium-argon dates to the early Jurassic, pushing it towards maybe the Triassic. And they found a whole bunch of footprints that looked like bird tracks. The initial explanation was, well, there were dinosaurs that looked like, that had footprints like bird tracks, and so this is just early dinosaur footprints. And then as time went on, people started noticing some strange things about these footprints, some of which looked like they started from nowhere, and the very first footprints had deep claw marks on the hind feet, suggesting that whatever these creatures were actually flew in and landed. Enough of this kind of evidence got there that people were kind of forced to call them birds. At this point, it became very uncomfortable because having birds that much before, or bird tracks that much before birds in the fossil record was a problem. So they went back and they used uranium lead dating to prove that this is actually well after the Jurassic. And so the, or I take it back, it's actually the Triassic when it was dated to begin with. It was the Triassic. And so they dated, and now if you go in, you will find that the people who said they were Triassic bird tracks have retracted everything because radiometric dating has proved that. Well, it's all fine and good, except that you have now trashed index fossils, and you have trashed potassium-argon dating. It obviously doesn't mean anything if it doesn't fit the storyline. So, yeah, I do have some problems with potassium-argon dating. I think Ariel has something he wants to say. Yeah, we'll get you next. Okay, you got it. Go ahead.
Dr. Geen, most of us know that Dr. Gentry's son, David Gentry, is a member of the Loma Linda University faculty. Have you ever considered inviting the son to come and give us an update on what his father is saying and what his father is teaching at this stage of his career?
I think we actually did that way back before we started doing the videos. I'll have to check on that. But if you're saying, could it be done again, I don't have a particular problem with it.
Well, I'd like very much to know what Sun Gentry has to say, and whether he is in full sympathy with what his father did so in a pioneering manner so many years back. And here we are, here's an answer.
We have an answer for that.
Yeah, here's Dr. Johns giving us the final word.
Well, it's just a librarian answer. Father and son have produced more than one video, I believe. So we need to first step is look at the video and see what they're saying, and then maybe that'll answer your question.
And there's one other point too, and that is that if you look at one of those references, I've forgotten which one, it's Gentry RV and then Gentry PA or whatever it was. So the answer is yes, they have cooperated. Ariel?
He was here and gave a lecture, full hour lecture. It was videoed by somebody else, not the present system we have here.
We did have him down. Well, we had Gentry Jr. here once as well, in
that's
addition.
That's what I'm speaking of.
How long ago was that? Somewhere in the Jurassic?
I couldn't tell you accurately.
I think it's actually Eocene, but...
and he, full agreement of his dad, very much... presenting his dad's viewpoint and so on. In fact, I remember asking him after he presented all these uranium halos, how were they formed? And he took about 10 minutes to answer it, and I was not sure what the answer was. 'Cause you do have to account if you're going to go into his model. You're going to have to form these uranium halos very rapidly. And this would involve, of course, leaving our traditional scientific interpretation that rates of decay don't vary.
Which and there is some evidence for, so it's not totally idiotic to try.
Yeah. Anyway, going on for our current discussion here, that questions raised and so on, I think one of the things we need to keep in mind in this whole radiometric dating issue is the effects of the flood. This complicates the picture. It complicates it in geology tremendously, but The effects of the flood on radiometric dates has not been studied adequately by creationists. And it needs to be considered. I think it may have affected some carbon 14 dates dramatically, but because we do seem to at least see a change, what we can postulate a change involving something like the flood type of thing. But coming back to an earlier question, which I think is a very good question, and that is, you know, why so many of these dates point to older ages. That doesn't help a person who's talking about 6,000 years, because both the older dates and which are not in agreement with standard geological time, and or those that are, and so on, do disagree with this. You'd like to see a lot of data that points to 6,000 years, if life has only been here on this Earth around that figure, or, you know, depending on different chronology, 7,000, 8,000. You do have to allow for some flexibility in that particular figure, but certainly not millions or billions of years, as is proposed for life. There is some data that seems to suggest that it can't be those billions of years, and maybe it's quite short. It's not very strong data. There's been some genetic data suggested at times point to 6,000. That's been, of course, debated very much in the scientific literature. I think the rate of reproduction of the human population tends to point towards, you know, just a few thousand years for humanity. We're doubling our population, you know, every 50 years or 100 years and so on. And things can vary human population rates of reproduction quite easily. Nevertheless, one does have to ask the question, because if you take our present 7 or 1 billion people, and you know, you cut that figure in half in every century, say reproduction, the population doubles every century, a conservative figure, just about 3 or 4, it's been a while since I've done that figure, but you get down to 2 people, which you need. You need 2 people to start the population. If man has been around for, Homo sapiens, been around for 200,000 years, and genus Homo around for 500,000 years, and some say, you know, 1 million or 2 million, so we're on the conservative side there, you do raise the question, you know, why is it that fossil man is so rare? You know, our cemeteries are getting overcrowded right now, our present population. Why is man so rare? And you get to I think, probably the more significant question. If man has been around that long, why is writing so recent? Why is the history so recent? These figures seem to point more in favor of the biblical model than they do the long ages model, per se, and I think we're not entirely without some data. Now, you've got other data that really challenge the long ages. The rates of erosion, for instance, very much challenge it. You've got that soft tissue in dinosaurs that we've talked about, and dating and so on. In fact, we talked about that last week. Not the soft tissue, we talked about the
carbon 14.
Yeah, I talked about carbon 14 dating and so on. So you've got that side of the figure. You've got the genetic entropy from Dr. Sanford and so on that again talks of a much shorter thing. So all the data doesn't point at 6,000. I think in part of it, you have to take into account the flood, which changes rates tremendously, especially in geology. But that's an implicit part of the creation model. and needs to be taken into account in any evaluation. I would say I would like to see more of the data pointing to 6,000, but there is some that points in that direction.
I realize you said you would be addressing potassium argon at another time, but it's been my impression that potassium argon dating is sort of considered a newer, more reliable method than the uranium lead, as though uranium lead is antiquated and potassium argon is more reliable. Is that the general consensus among those, even though I don't think either is very apropos to our 6,000 years theory?
I think what they would tell you is it depends on the specimen. The ideal thing, of course, is for potassium argon and uranium lead to come up with the exact same date, and rubidium strontium to give you that same date as well. There are a few cases in the literature where that's true. There are more cases where they kind of are in the same ballpark, but not exactly. Usually that's explained by the magma slowly cooling, and at first the zircons close, so they don't exchange lead anymore, and then the hornblende closes so that you have potassium argon from the hornblende older, and then you have biotite closing, and then you have whole rock rubidium strontium, and then you have finally potassium argon and insanidine. The San Bernardino Mountains have a whole suite of dates that are like that.
I know in the John Day fossil beds, their museum there touts the fact that they're using potassium argon as a more reliable way of age dating that material. Does that apply to rocks primarily?
Well, yes, it applies to rocks pretty much strictly. There isn't any tissue that we have where potassium is locked up. We lock up calcium and phosphate and carbonate, and that's about it in bone. Potassium is pretty water soluble. When it gets locked up, it's usually in minerals that will form crystals big enough to where water doesn't affect the inside of them very much. So virtually all the potassium argon, in fact, I think I can safely say all the potassium argon dates that are out there are done on rocks that are not fossils. Yes.
I was talking to a scientist. I had a question about the potassium argon dating on a marine deposit. So I called up one of the scientists. I had a paper on it in Menlo Park. USGS.
That's Dalrymple Stomping Grounds.
Yeah. And he said, well, he says, I can't answer you on that, but let me talk. You talk to so-and-so, and I can't remember the names right now, I'm sorry, who deals more with marine stuff, you know. And so he transferred me to this other scientist instead of scientist. Well, marine stuff, we're not paying too much attention to these dates because of the influence of water and so on potassium argon dating. And I can tell you get a great variety of dates in potassium argon dating. There's a nice article in Science about how the deeper you go, the older the dates are because of the hydrostatic pressure of the water prevents the escape of the argon, and so the lower the sample is, the further it dates. You know, this is an automatic system for producing a sequence of dates, which would be wrong, because these were on lava flows from Hawaii that are quite recent. So you've got some things indicate, you know, when you start thinking about a flood, hydrostatic pressure and so on, you can quickly put together a model that, hey, all these potassium argon dates are due to pressure. And it's dangerous to make such a rapid generalization, but there's a suggestion there that you could try that out.
There is no gold standard in dating. Even even carbon-14 is now recognized to have fudge factors that have to be thrown in. And of course, that raises the question of have we thrown in the correct fudge factors. But potassium-argon works apparently well some places. At least it gives us the dates we expect. Uranium-lead sometimes gives us the dates we expect. And rubidium-strontium sometimes gives us the dates we expect. There are actually, according to Guy and Schleicher, 76 different ways of dating. And I assume that the reason why they're all there is because no one particular dating system is so foolproof that you can quit once you get it. But it's actually a fairly long subject. If I were to refer you to some place where at least a good collection of stuff is that can get you started looking at what the dating methods are and what their problems are, I could do worse than refer you to the book I wrote, Scientific Theology, which is now available online free.
Yeah, I want to provide a partial answer for this gentleman's question up there on the upper level. Very good question, by the way. Excellent question. My expertise in dating is just a little slice of the geological column. I have a master's in Pleistocene geology, and that's the icing on the cake. Pleistocene geology relies much more heavily on potassium-argon than any other method. Why? Uranium-lead, as you know, decays so slowly that you're not going to have a whole lot of decay in the Pleistocene, right, compared to Paleozoic or Mesozoic. And so for the upper crust, the icing on the cake, you need potassium-argon. Now, another thing is precision. A lot of the potassium-argon dates are with not lava flows, but ash falls, ash beds. And they form a thin layer in the middle of some geological strata. And that's very precise. Whereas if you date like Yosemite, one of these batholiths that cools over an indefinite period of time, you're not going to have a good, you might say, foothold into the surrounding strata. When did that batholith, granite, push up? And granite, you have mostly uranium-lead dating and also isochron and strontium and some of these other methods. So for precision, especially if you're in the geological column and it's one layer after another, if you can find an ash bed, you've really struck gold, and that's what they use. And that's why they use it mostly for the hominids, supposed ancestors. I don't agree with the idea that we're descended from all these ancestors. They keep changing our pedigree all the time. But they use it for that, 3 to 4 million years. And there's a book after the Australopithecines, been out for 30 years. And that was the first time that they really relied heavily on potassium-argon dating for dating fossil hominids. And that's how they come up with the dates for all these ancient.
There's one other piece of information that's kind of interesting, and that is that actually potassium-argon dating has now fallen out of favor because of some difficulties, and what they do now is what they call argon-argon dating, which is actually based on potassium-argon dating, but instead of dating whole rock, or they date each little individual crystal. And there's some fascinating maneuvers to get that to happen. They have to bombard these things with neutrons to form argon 39, and they measure the 39 to 40 ratio and the 36 to 40 ratio. And 39 comes from potassium 39 if you do the neutron radiation just right. And so even potassium argon dating, they're trying to move beyond it, presumably because they didn't like the dates they were getting.
But argon dating has some of the very basic, same basic problems that potassium argon dating has. And the problem, one of the major problems, of course, is this excess argon picture. The further you go down into rocks, at least one study points out, the more excess argon and the more excess helium you find. That is data, of course, that goes contrary to what was presented here this morning in connection with this Yemes caldera, I guess you call it, Fenton Hill?
Yeah.
That data, here we have an increase in excess argon, an increase in excess helium as you go further down in the rocks. And geologists interpret this as some degassing process in the past. I would not have trouble suggesting maybe the flood would have caused some degassing.
Or maybe the flood that prevented degassing of the further down layers. In which case it looks older and it really isn't.
Yeah, you don't have to degassing to get to the excess. You know? Sometimes you find 1,000 times as much argon as you're supposed to find there, even for samples that are billions of years old. So reality is not as simple as our minds like to make it. And we must keep that constantly in mind. Our conclusions do have to remain tentative.
Do we have one more comment up here?
Yeah. As a single male, I find all this discussion about dating techniques to be fascinating. I compliment you for such a relevant Sabbath school. I'll have to try it on my next date. We'll see how it goes. I'll give a report. Dr. Roth, it's actually, I did the calculations, and it's at doubling every 100 years, which could be conservative, it would take 3,300 years to go from two people to 8 billion. So,
yeah. We might add to that, I did not mention the good evidence of human activity is also fairly recent. I'm talking about pyramids, I'm talking about aqueducts, I'm talking about roads and so on. We don't find that stuff further back than a few thousand years. I think the question can be raised, if man has been here that long, it doesn't look like it, both in terms of the population size and the solid evidence. You can find, you know, some people, well, no, we found this little slanted piece of material here. We think it's a house, and we dated it by carbon-14 at 20,000 years and so on, and man has been here. There is that data there. I'm speaking of the good solid data of man's existence. It seems to be fairly recent.
Oh. Another comment back.
One final comment, and we have to go, in response to what Dr. Roth says.
It's probably a good idea to quit at this point.
Pardon?
I said it's probably a good idea to quit after this, so go ahead.
All right. I would certainly agree that the sudden emergence of civilization around 6,000 years ago in ancient Sumer indicates an entirely different level of human functioning than anything that existed previously. However, either the evolutionary hypothesis or the creationist hypothesis can be interpreted in a way that's consistent with that fact, because the kind of intelligence that would permit building grid pattern cities and calculating eclipses and astronomical events precisely and leaving calendrical records and architecture that's oriented to the stars and so on. All of that could either be an emergent property as a result of evolving to a higher level, or it could be the result of creation that occurred 6,000 years ago. You can interpret it either way, it seems to me.
I would have to agree with you. I don't think that I don't think that that's a knockdown argument. It's a, you know, kind of a makes you wonder kind of thing, but as is true most of the time, we still don't have a silver bullet for either side. But I think that kids should know that those facts are out there if we're teaching them and we're trying to be fair. And I think that's the point I'm trying to make in this whole series.
Are you making this point to the people who design our education?
Actually, I may be preaching to the choir, but we're recording this so that at a later date I can show it to the other people. Nah. Oh well, I will say one other point, and then I will shut up. And that is that the carbon-14 material that we talked about last week, I'm supposed to be presenting that to a group of educators in North America this coming August. So, yes, we are moving. More slowly than I would like, but, you know, you do what you can.
More slowly than I would like.
So, anyway... See you next week, and those of you who get the email will get your updates.